It's me, Gleb. In this video, we'll once again explore the process of converting the bas-relief photos, I mean real photography, but basically any images, to depth maps using Materialise free application, or better yet, Stable Diffusion Depth Extraction, which is quite phenomenal. And then using these maps for displacing a real geometry in Blender. This is a really accessible sculpting method anyone can give a go. So yeah, previously in this course we've taken a look at the statistical image generation with Stable Diffusion for creating the source images for this technique, which is a more controversial and ethically ambiguous method. This time though, we'll use the sources from Pixabay and Unsplash, basically real photos. In this video, we'll also touch upon a 3D method of creating bas-reliefs based on combining 3D meshes from Sketchfab to create intricate sculptural details. Okay, the first method of converting images to height maps is a free Materialise app. It isn't perfect, yet it works. First, we just click O to open our source image. I'll choose one of the ancient bas-relief photos from the bas-relief chapter resources from the course. Non-AI. Let's see what we've got here. The less distortion we've got, the better. But even something like that would do. The camera angle isn't perfectly straight, but it's okay. Now I'll click Create to generate the height map based on that image. Using Displace usually works pretty well, as for avoiding the noisy details. And then we can set it as height map. I'll choose the TIFF format, as it's probably the best one out of this bunch, and click Save. I'll save it near the original colorful image. I'll just call it depth. So this is the resulting depth or height map, and we can do that for a few more images this process. All of these are CC0 photos from Unsplash and Pixabay, I believe. Okay, we just need to convert them to depth, although it's not technically speaking a true depth by any means, but it will do for now at least. A better method would be actually use Stable Diffusion with the add-on called DepthMap script. I won't be going through the installation of Stable Diffusion, feel free to check the Kevin Stratford video, or any other tutorial for installation of Stable Diffusion for that matter. Anyway, the DepthMap script is installed via extensions. Here you can see it's already been set up. Stable Diffusion, Web UI, DepthMap script. To install it, you can visit this GitHub page by Thighgate, and basically copy its URL. Then all you need to do is press install from URL and paste it here and click install. After that it should pop up in the installed add-ons. Maybe apply and restart UI button has to be clicked as well. If it went well, the depth tab should become available at the top. Then it's super easy, even a bit too easy if you know what I mean. Just drop any image here, select a model, depth anything base is a really good start in my opinion, but there are other models like Midas that could be worth trying. Then usually I just tick the boost checkbox, because it makes it a higher definition map or texture, and after that you can just hit generate and wait. It shouldn't take terribly long. Depending on your GPU, it's in seconds or in minutes. Swoosh! Eventually the depth map should become generated, and usually it's really, really good. We just need to save it. Usually it blows the Materialise height maps out of the water. This is the Materialise and this is the Stable Diffusion depth script for comparison. And there is no competition in my view, this is just better, hands down. No matter the source images, in my tests, SD-generated depth maps have been just better at guessing the geometry behind the photo. The results honestly are quite impressive in comparison to more traditional algorithmic methods. Then in Blender we need a plane with a couple of subdivisions. Right-click, subdivide, or press Shift-R to repeat multiple times. Alternatively, we can use the subdivision surface modifier to add that extra resolution. Okay, we can switch off the optimal display to see the true topology. All right, maybe more. Nope, a million polygons is a bit too high for this demo, I think. So I'll stick to three subdivisions, then press Ctrl A to apply this modifier. and this should make it ready for the displace modifier, which you can obviously find in the modifiers section. Now we need a new texture. We can call it however you like and come over to the texture tab and select the image. Again, I'll use the coarse resources, bas-relief source images. Non-AI. Let's check the thumbnails. Here we have the materialized depth maps. And I've also exported the SD depth maps as well into the alt folder. The higher quality depth maps, you know. So probably let's go with this one. The amplitude of the displacement can be tweaked here in the modifier itself, alongside the mid-level, if you need to tweak it as well. Yeah, at a lower amplitude, I'd say it looks more or less passable, even though it's still fairly mangled, to be honest. It shows that it's not a true depth approximation, okay? Not super impressive. Now I'll shift D to copy it out to show you something else. This time let's use an alternative depth map from SD. So I'll click cross to get rid of this one. And then I'll open up a new one, which is gonna be the displacement from the display from the depth maps SD folder. This one, I think. Yeah, as you can see, it's light years apart in terms of quality. Don't pay attention that it's stretched vertically, we'll fix that shortly. But the difference is night and day, as the script seems to be predicting the depth or volume based on that single image in a creepily realistic way, I'd say. On the other hand, it's possible that this is one of those benefits of neural networks that comes at the expense of the artists, photographers and others whose works were used to train the neural model, likely without their consent. I wonder what do you think? Like, sure, it is cool, but at what cost? Who really benefits from this and who ends up paying the price? One could argue that depth map generation has historically been an incredibly challenging problem to solve in computer graphics. With more traditional methods, it's just notoriously difficult to derive depth analytically, similarly to, you know, rigging, retopology, or even UV packing, also super notorious tasks. These are all areas of maximum tediousness that could potentially benefit from the use of so-called AI. I wonder what do you think? Okay, back to work. Speaking about UVs, the UVs have to be slightly corrected, so I will open the UV editor in a separate window. And then I will find the texture that we've used. I believe it's this one. The thing is, currently it's fairly stretched, I mean the UV map. To fix it, I'll switch the coordinates to UV, hit Tab to enter edit mode, then A to select all polygons. Dragging the selection rectangle won't cut it, it's better to just press A. Then I will switch off the viewport overlays to see what we're doing, and I will activate this icon to display the changes in the edit mode. It should still be selected. Okay. Then I'll hit S to scale, Y to scale it vertically, to give it roughly a square shape. And then I will simply scale it down uniformly. We can also type G to move this UV island around. I'm just trying to find the sweet spot. I think it looks decent. Again, it's important to enable UV coordinates. Now I'll duplicate it once more with Shift-D. And I will update its texture to something else. Open. Now let's go with something else. This one, perhaps? Again, this is the SD version. It looks perfect to me, simply can't be better if you ask me. That's some black magic for sure. Okay, Tab, if you want to tweak the coordinates. Actually, what's the texture? Let's select the right one. S to scale, G to move, R to rotate if needed. So far so good. For a demo, I'll copy it out again with Shift-D, just to show how the materialized depth map would differ from this. Where is it? Nothing to write home about, right? It works and doesn't require installing a convoluted SD setup, but gosh, is this one crispier. Anyway, another method of how we can approach creating ancient bas-reliefs in Blender is actually by combining 3D meshes together. The meshes found on Sketchfab, for instance. The meshes that feature a permissive license, ideally. So let's explore this 3D method. We'll also start from a plane, just for a reference. Then, to import the models downloaded from Sketchfab, we can just drag these files into our viewport and choose Import. And then arrange it roughly on that plane. It might involve some trial and error, I mean, in choosing the meshes and so on. So I'm going to import a couple more to see what works and what not. In this method, we are kind of constrained by what we can find online and what we can use, if not resorting to PhotoScan and so on. So, yeah, otherwise it's a pretty powerful workflow. Okay. Maybe yet another one. Alright, if you're watching this bonus video on YouTube, all the links to these models should be found in the description. Let me know in the comments or on our Discord if you face any issues with that. Okay, that's a nice one too. Could cover a slightly wider wall for sure. Let's see, if you have a model like that, that you want to fit into these dimensions and square proportions, what we can do is create a cube. Imagine it's a boundary object. Then shift-click the sculpture and go shift numpad minus or plus for the boolean operation, then change it immediately to intersect to cut out everything that falls outside that box, and that should do the trick. Once you're done, apply the boolean modifier. And we can get rid of this object too. Now I'll ditch the shader, cause we don't really need it, and bring this object into the mix to make it a part of the bas-relief. Yeah, it's a bit sloppy. I hope you don't mind. It should be fine. Okay, that's looking good to me. To merge these objects in anticipation of what comes next, we need to select both of these objects, then right-click and join them together. Cool. And now the plane comes back into the game. It needs to be on top, like that. If you've lost it somewhere, just create a new one from the Shift-A menu. It has to be given more resolution though, so I will subdivide it a few times, Shift-R to repeat until it's fairly dense. 131k sounds good. Dense enough, for sure. And finally, deform shrink wrap. What we'll do in a moment is wrap it around this sculpture, which we have to set as a target. Not looking good so far. The thing is, the snap mode should be changed to project. And the direction to negative. Alright. That spike, I think we can just scale down this plane a bit. Alright, the offset can be used to unglue it from the target mesh ever so slightly, so we can check its topology and whatnot. Maybe it will be easier if we give it a contrasting color as well. That would definitely make it stand out. How about red? Okay, now we're talking. So what we did is projected the topology of this plane straight down onto the geometry underneath, just like that. Yeah, we should be good, I think. We don't need the source geometry anymore, or the target geometry, rather. What is this protrusion? I think we can nudge it ever so slightly to get it out of that part of the depth map, the part that captures that detail. Yeah. I think it did the trick. Actually, the shrink wrap modifier works even if the target mesh is hidden in the viewport. It will still be shrink wrapped unless you collapse the modifier stack. It mostly looks fine, suffering from some minor issues here and there. Anyway, actually one more thing we can do is scale down the target mesh on the Z axis if needed. you know, to change the strength of the displacement. We can think of it in these terms. It isn't necessary, of course, but could be worth trying. Once we're ready, the modifier can be collapsed or applied. So this is the result. I think it looks really, really solid. There are just a couple of minor issues to address, really. Like, do we need the red color any longer? It doesn't matter. But there is no more emergency, so it can get back to neutral. Yeah, we can scale it or change its height at any point also. And now it would be fantastic if we could fix that stretching that was caused by shrink wrap. For that, we can use the remesh modifier to reprogram the topology of this object. The problem is, it won't work with that non-watertight or infinitely thin geometry. It needs to have some volume to it. What we can do to give it some volume is probably the easiest we can do is select the outer edges and extrude them. So I'll hit Tab to enter the edit mode, make sure all edges are selected, A to do that, then search for Select Boundary Loop, and that will highlight the outer region. So it can be extruded down with the E key. Then straightened out by going S, then Z and 0. And finally, I'll create a new face there by... Well, I don't see anything. Let's move it there. So I'll create a new face by pressing F. Good. Now, technically, it should be a watertight, aka manifold object. And as such, it should work just fine with the voxel remeshing. Yeah, as you can see, it's now a nice, solid piece of geometry. Okay, remesh modifier. And be careful with nudging that slider. It's better to click and type it in manually. So 0.01. Or even more granular, perhaps 0.005. Yep, I think that will do. It's a good, even grid now. We can apply this modifier now to collapse it. And that means it could be ready to receive any extra sculpting you may want to unleash, if anything. Now, given it has a nice, even topology, sculpting should be pretty fluent and fun, all things considered. Maybe it could be a good opportunity to bring in some of these custom brushes that we've included in the resources of that course, the rocky brushes that use VDM or vector displacement mapping. The rest is up to you, really, how detailed you want it to be and whether you'll take it through the rest of the process, including texturing and baking and various optimizations for game engines and whatnot, the other stuff that we explore later in this course. To sum it up, though, in this video we explored two important techniques for creating intricate bas-reliefs, one image-based, deriving depth maps from 2D images, and other one involving 3D meshes and the shrink wrap modifier for achieving a similar effect. In the course, we take it a step further, and quite a risky step, to show more of a generative approach, generating the source image itself in stable diffusion, realizing a controversial nature of the techniques and tools being discussed, yet trying to strike a balance. If you want to get the full course, it is available on Blender Market, aka Superhive, and on our Gumroad as well. It is called Game Asset Workflow. That was me, Gleb Alexandrov, for CreativeShrimp.com, and I wish you to stay creative. Take care.